Quilters Newsletter TV, the Quilters community, is brought to you by Handy Quilter, designed by a quilter for quilters. Sulky, express yourself with Sulky and create with confidence. Brother, it's so easy with Brother at your side. And Quilt Cut, easy fabric cutting for quilters. Hi, and welcome to Quilters Newsletter TV, the Quilters community. I'm Mary Kate Karpetras. I'm an associate editor at Quilters Newsletter. And with me today is Lori Baker, who is our creative editor. And Lori is known for being a really fast sewer, and I am not. In fact, this quilt here in front of us is an Ohio Star that Lori made for our Best Fat Quarter Quilts issue from 2012. And I remember you went into the sewing room. You pulled a bunch of fat quarters that coordinated, and you came back next week with a completed top, I believe.
Yes.
And I was astounded. And then the next week it was basically a completed quilt. So even something simple, quote unquote simple, like an Ohio Star, this is a queen size?
It's a big queen
size. Big queen size quilt. So, I mean, this is something that, you know, if you're like me, I only have maybe sometimes 15 minutes a day to sew, because apparently sleep is optional with my kids these days. So, you know, even at night after I put them to bed, I'm really limited, and there are a lot of people who have limited little chunks of time. So today we want to talk about Lori's speed sewing tips and how you made this in such a short amount of time, because you have a full-time job.
Right.
You know, you're not able to just sit there all day
just
sew. So that's what we want to talk about. And to, you know, there are certain things even with an Ohio Star. You know, you've got a whole patch. You've got that patch in the center that's just a patch. And then you've got half square triangle units. And you've got little hourglass units. And each
right.
one can present its own little quirk in terms of how you piece it.
That's correct.
So please walk us through some of your tips for how you turned out this quilt so quickly and how we can apply those tips to the rest of our piecing.
Okay. So the first thing I have to warn you is I can't give you any hints that are going to save you hours and hours on your quilt. But what I'm
okay.
going to try to do is show you how to save seconds on each and every step.
Okay.
And when you do that step over all the pieces in each block, you do save up a considerable chunk of time. So the first thing you need is a good sewing machine in good running order.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to take my machine in for a clean and check every 6 months. But I sew a lot.
Right.
The normal quilter probably once a year is fine. I need second tool is a good iron.
Okay.
I like an iron that has steam. I think I get crisper edges and things are easier to make fit together.
Okay. Do you use starch?
I do use starch.
Okay.
I make my own from concentrate and I do half and half.
Okay. That's really heavy.
So it's nice and stiff.
Yeah, that's really heavy.
Yes.
Okay.
Then we need the biggest mat that you have room for,
mm-hmm.
so you don't have to be folding and moving your material around all the time. You can just put it in place and then start cutting.
Okay.
We need a good ruler.
Yes. And do you like a particular width or size?
I don't think that particularly matters,
okay.
as long as it still has a nice crisp edge and you're not getting funky cuts because the edge of your ruler's nicked. And
okay.
Then, of course, a good rotary cutter.
Yes.
With a good blade.
Yes.
Not nicked.
Yes. Or even dull.
That's
mean, they
right.
do dull, and they just dull over time, and you don't even realize it until you put a new blade in. Then it's like a world
That's
of difference.
Absolutely
that can really
true.
Impede your cutting if you're having to do it a couple of
exactly.
times.
Exactly. Exactly. A good pair of scissors, and I want a pair of scissors that's sharp, clear to the point.
Okay.
So that I can cut clear out to the very
yeah.
and get a crisp cut.
Mm-hmm.
And then I also want a pair of snips that I can lay by my sewing machine.
Very good.
Just little tiny ones for just the threads.
Do you ever get your shears sharpened? Do you take them to knife sharpening, or you don't find that to be an issue?
I actually do get them sharpened,
okay.
but I'm more inclined to just buy a new pair.
Okay. So whatever it takes.
Exactly.
Whatever it takes is to be sharp, whatever
yes,
you prefer.
Okay. Exactly.
Great.
Then the next thing we're going to do is we're going to talk about cutting, because here's a place that I think I can save you
okay.
a good amount of time. And that is, remember I said I wanted a sharp blade in my rotary
mm-hmm.
cutter? I cut multiple layers of fabric at a time. So I have my fabric placed specifically so that it's right sides together. So I have the bottom two pieces are right sides together, and then the top two pieces are right sides together.
And this is how you made this Ohio Star quilt.
Exactly.
And you already knew which fabrics you wanted to pair.
Exactly.
So it's not just a random right sides together. You've already kind of designed your
absolutely.
Look.
Okay. So these two were paired together and vice and on through the quilt. I do four layers at a time because that's how much I can cut accurately. If you're younger, stronger, whatever, and can cut six, well, go for it. But four is what works accurately for me.
Nice and manageable.
Yes. I also make sure that I keep my pinky out here on the mat so that the ruler's not going to slip.
That is an issue. And I noticed that you cut with your cut pieces underneath your ruler rather than cutting them over to the side of your ruler.
Correct.
And do you find that makes a difference in your speed or accuracy?
I think it makes a difference in my accuracy, and I also think it makes a difference in how quickly I can get things picked up and stacked.
Okay.
Because that's the next thing I do. As I finish cutting things, I put them in a nice, neat, and tidy stack.
Okay.
I want the light fabric up on each and every set of triangles. I want the same edge of the triangle in the same spot. So in other words, I don't want some of them turned this way and some of them turned this way, so that I can get the most effective economic placement so it goes under the foot on the machine quickly. Each and every one is going to go the same way every time.
Okay, and you also, you sewed this in chunks.
Yes.
My very technical term, where you did all of your half square triangles.
Yes.
All of your hourglasses, you know, and you just did it very methodically, like an assembly line.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. And then when we get to the sewing machine, I'm not afraid to sew pedal to the metal. Mm-hmm. I'm going to chain piece so that everything's all hooked together. I do not use pins.
Okay.
But I use my fingers as pins.
Okay.
So that when I place this under, everything's all lined up because it came from the cutting board already in order. And I'm going to just get it started.
So you just place your fingers at a couple of inches apart from one another.
Exactly. And that's basically pinned. And before I get to it, I just move my finger.
Okay. And you're not stretching it because obviously you're on the bias there.
Correct.
So you're just holding it.
I'm just holding the edges so that they stay in the right position. I do think it's a cool thing to use the features on your machine. If you've got snips, use them.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we get to cutting, I like to use the weight of the fabric to keep the fabric out of the way. So I hold my scissors and the fabric's out of the way so I can just cut.
Okay.
Cut. And again, I'm going to line things up in a specific order.
Okay.
Another thing that I do want to talk about is that the foot is one of the reasons I feel like I can go pedal to the metal, because it has this nifty little guide on the side of it, this little blade that's upright here.
Yes.
And I run my fabric into that, and then my fabric only has one way that it can go and not be in position rather than floating all over the place when you don't have a guide.
So part of the speed sewing tips is you let your tools work for you.
Absolutely.
Let them take the, you know, do the work that they were intended
Absolutely.
To do for you. Okay, great.
So now we're ready to move to the pressing station.
Okay.
And again, I keep everything all in the same order.
Okay.
So I have the dark print up and all the triangles lined up the same way.
Mm-hmm.
So I can just pull this open and press, and my seam's going to go to the dark side.
And you press on that stack.
Yeah.
You're not moving it over.
Exactly.
Oh, wow. Okay.
It's one less thing have to do.
We're talking about just a couple of seconds here and there.
Exactly.
Okay. And would you be starching at this point?
That would depend on how crisp a press I'm getting.
Okay.
If I'm getting a good crisp press, then I don't bother with starch at this point.
Great.
Another thing about pressing is that I do nest my seams, so I don't have to pin. On this particular mm-hmm. one, I've got these seams are pressing to the outside, so the ones that they're opposing are pressed to the inside. Mm-hmm. And I can just take my fingers and smoosh that nesting into position, yep. and I'm ready to sew. And again, I don't pin. I'm just going to hold that when I put it under the machine.
Okay, so because sometimes, not that this ever happens to me, but again, with something like this where you've got different wonkinesses that can occur with yes. half square triangles or hourglass units,
right.
and then whole patches, sometimes you might need to use in a little fullness or something like that when you're nesting in those seams, even with really specific accurate cutting and,
yes.
and stitching.
And in that case, I always sew with needle down. And when I'm ready to start sewing, mm-hmm. I'm going to take one or two stitches at the beginning of this, and then I'm going to hold this in position,
okay.
and I can go ahead because the needle's down, and I can stretch just that little smidgen you need
okay.
to make it so it all matches
mm-hmm.
again.
Mm-hmm. Okay, see, this is a great little tip. Very good. And what you can't see necessarily with the entire quilt is just how specific her points are on this quilt. I mean, you said you don't round up when you're cutting half square triangle units.
That's correct.
You cut, you know, if you need a 3-inch finished size, you cut your patches 3 7/8 inch.
Correct.
And some people will round up and then trim, which you don't do, and you still have very, very specific sharp points that are not cut off or floating.
Right.
And so these are all great little tips to help us with that. Do you have anything else that you want to float our way?
Yeah, one other thing that occurs to me when I look at the quilt is that the outside stripped border mm-hmm. is finished 6 inches because the ruler I was using was 6.5.
Okay.
So that made it so I could cut that border really fast mm-hmm. just using the width of the ruler.
Mm-hmm. Just make your tools work for you.
Exactly.
Again. These are great. Well, thank you so much, Lori. I know we work side by side, but we don't really sew next to one another.
That's
I mean,
right.
that's not really what we're here to do. And so it's really nice to have her come into the studio and show us some of her little tips and tricks. We hope that you found something in this that you can use. If you have any other, if you want to see any other episodes of Quilters Newsletter TV, you can visit our website. They're available free and online anytime you want to watch them. So we hope we'll see you again next time. Quilters Newsletter TV, the Quilters community, is brought to you by Handy Quilter, designed by a quilter for quilters. Sulky, express yourself with Sulky and create with confidence. Brother, it's so easy with Brother at your side. And Quilt Cut, easy fabric cutting for quilters.